Hello everyone, welcome back to the next session of Data Science with Python Programming. I hope you remember in a previous session we have seen the classification. Under the classification we have seen classification algorithms such as the first one we have seen logistic regression, next we have seen decision tree algorithm, and the third one we have seen support vector machine algorithm. Yeah, do you remember? And under the regression we have seen implementation of simple linear regression, multiple linear regression, and polynomial regression. Okay, so till now what we have seen supervised machine learning, the theory about it. Under the supervised learnings are classified into two categories of algorithm. First one is regression, second one is classification. So we have seen what are the algorithms under the regression and what are the algorithms under the classifications. Now it's time for us to proceed with next type of machine learning, that is unsupervised machine learning. And by the way, I hope you remember, unsupervised machine learning are also categorized or classified into two categories of algorithm. First one is clustering, second one is association. Do you remember? So now in this session, we are going to start clustering. Okay. And by the way, I hope you know what is clustering? Yeah, we have seen the theory about it. Am I right? So now in this session, we will learn more about clustering and we will also implement the algorithms under the clustering. So let me show you what you are going to learn exactly in this session. So see, you will start with the first point, what is clustering? And then clustering algorithms. So under the clustering algorithm, the first algorithm you will learn, K means clustering. Okay, the theory about it, and then how does K means clustering work? You will see how does it work. You will learn it, and then I will show you the implementation of K means clustering with the help of Python code. Okay, and then next you will learn hierarchical clustering. Okay, and then you will learn agglomerative hierarchical clustering, and how does agglomerative hierarchical clustering work? And then you will learn divisive hierarchical clustering. And finally, you will learn the implementation of agglomerative hierarchical clustering. Got it? So let's start with the first point. What is clustering? So tell me. So see here, as you know that unsupervised learning is the training of the machine using information that is neither classified nor labeled, and allowing the algorithm to act on that information without guidance. Here the task of the machine is to group unsorted information according to the similarities, patterns, and differences without any prior training of data. Yeah, unsupervised learning classified into two categories of algorithms. So first one is clustering, second one is association. So in this session you will learn about clustering. Okay, so what is clustering? See here. Clustering is an important concept when it comes to unsupervised learning. It mainly deals with finding a structure or a pattern in a collection of uncategorized data. Clustering algorithm will process your data and find natural clusters or groups if they exist in the data. You can also modify how many clusters your algorithm should identify. It allows you to adjust the granularity of these groups. Clustering is one of the most frequently utilized forms of unsupervised learning. Got it? Yeah. So clustering is mainly deal with the finding the structure or the pattern in a collection of uncategorized data. Clustering algorithm will process your data and find the natural cluster or the groups if they exist in the data. You can also modify how many clusters your algorithm should identify. It allows you to adjust the granularity of these groups. Clustering is one of the most frequently utilized form of unsupervised learning. Okay. So see here, let's suppose if you have sample of data or the collection of data, if you apply clustering to it, so what does it do? Based on the similarity of the object, it is going to make a group like this one. Okay. So this is sample. This is a cluster of it. It is often used as a data analysis technique for discovering interesting pattern in data, such as group of customers based on their behavior. Okay, so clustering is often used as a data analysis technique for discovering interesting patterns in data, such as groups of customer based on their behavior. There are many clustering algorithms to choose from, and no single best clustering algorithm for all the cases. Okay, instead, it is good idea to explore a range of clustering algorithm and different configuration for each algorithm. It involves automatically discovering natural grouping in data. Unlike supervised learning, clustering algorithms only interpret the input data and find natural groups or the clusters in a feature space. Got it? Clustering technique apply when there is no class to be predicted, but rather when the instances are to be divided into a natural clustering into the natural groups. Clustering techniques apply when there is no class to be predicted, but rather when the instances are to be divided into natural groups. Clustering is the task of dividing the population or the data points into a number of groups, such that the data point in the same groups are more similar to other data point in the same group and dissimilar to the data points in other groups. Are you getting the point? Clustering is a task of dividing the data point into the number of groups, such that the data point in the same group are more similar to each other in the same group and dissimilar to the data points in other groups. It is basically a collection of objects on the basis of similarity and dissimilarity between them. Okay. Now let's see clustering algorithm. So as of now, I hope you got a brief idea, a brief understanding, a clear understanding of clustering. Yeah. Now let's see clustering algorithms. There are many types of clustering algorithms. Many algorithms use similarity or distance measure between example in a feature space in an effort to discover dense regions of observation. As such, it is often good practice to scale data prior to using clustering algorithms. Some clustering algorithms require you to specify or guess at the number of clusters to discover in the data, whereas others require the specification of some minimum distance between observations in which example may be considered close or connected. Okay. Each algorithm offers a different approach to the challenge of discovering natural groups in data. There is no best clustering algorithm and no easy way to find the best algorithm for your data without using the controlled experiments. There are various types of clustering algorithm, such as k-means clustering, hierarchical clustering, mean shift clustering, etc. And each of these algorithms offer a different approach to the challenge of discovering the natural groups in the data. Okay, there is no best clustering algorithm and no easy way to find the best algorithm for your data without using controlled experiment. Okay, so there are various types of clustering algorithms, such as k-means clustering, hierarchical clustering, mean shift clustering, etc. So here we will cover some of the important clustering algorithm. Got it? So let's start with the first clustering algorithm, that is k-means clustering. Okay, so see, k-means is considered by many to be the gold standard when it comes to the clustering due to its simplicity and performance. So it's the first one we will try out. Yeah, you might think why we should start with k-means clustering algorithm. Yeah, because k-means is considered by many to be the gold standard when it comes to clustering due to its simplicity and performance. So it's the first algorithm we should try it. Okay. K-means clustering is one of the simplest and popular unsupervised machine learning algorithm. Okay. When you have no idea at all what algorithms to use, k-means is usually the first choice. Okay, are you getting the points? So when you have no idea about the clustering algorithm or what algorithm to use in case of clustering, k-means is usually the first choice. K-means algorithm partition n observation into k cluster, where each observation belongs to the cluster with the nearest mean serving as a prototype of the cluster. Are you getting the point? K-means algorithm partition n observation into k cluster, where each observation belongs to the cluster with the nearest mean serving as a prototype of the cluster. Okay. You will define the target number k, which refers to the number of centroid you need in the data set. Okay, so here you need to define a target number k, which is nothing but the number of centroid you need in the data set. A centroid is the imaginary or real location representing the center of the cluster. Representing the center of the cluster or center of the group. In other words, the k-means algorithm identifies k number of centroid and then allocate every data point to the nearest cluster while keeping the centroid as small as possible. Are you getting the point? How it's work? K-means algorithm identifies k number of centroid. What is centroid? A centroid is the imaginary or real location representing the center of the cluster. Okay, so k-means clustering identifies k number of centroid and then allocate every data point to the nearest cluster while keeping the centroid as small as possible. The term means, yeah, what is the name of the algorithm we are studying? K-means. So the term means in the k-means refer to the averaging of the data, that is finding the centroid. Okay, what is the meaning of this means here in k-means algorithm? The means in a k-means refer to averaging of the data, that is finding the centroid. Are you getting the point? So k-means algorithm identifies k number of centroid and then allocate every data point to the nearest cluster while keeping the centroid as small as possible. Okay, are you getting it? And the means, what is this means? The means in k-means clustering is referred to the averaging of data point, that is finding the centroid. Okay, got it? K-means is a centroid-based algorithm or distance-based algorithm, where we calculate the distance to assign a point to a cluster. Okay, k-means clustering is a centroid-based algorithm or distance-based algorithm, where we calculate the distance, where we calculate the distances to assign a data point to a cluster. In k-means, each cluster is associated with a centroid. The main objective of the k-means algorithm is to minimize the sum of distances between the points and their respective cluster centroid. Got the point? The main objective of the k-means algorithm is to minimize the sum of distances between the points and their respective cluster centroid. Okay, so in k-means clustering, you identify the k number of centroid and then you allocate every data point to the nearest cluster while keeping the centroid as small as possible. Okay, so in k-means clustering, you identify k, that is number of centroid, and then allocate each data point to the nearest cluster while keeping the centroid as small as possible. K-means clustering is centroid-based algorithm or distance-based algorithm, where we calculate the distances to assign a point to a cluster. In k-means, each cluster is associated with a centroid. And what is centroid? Tell me. It is a imaginary or real location. A centroid is a imaginary or real location representing the center of the cluster. Okay. The main objective of k-means algorithm is to minimize the sum of distances between the point and their respective cluster centroid. Got it? Now it's time for us to understand how does the k-means clustering work. So see, k-means is a centroid based algorithm or a distance based algorithm where we calculate the distance to assign a point to a cluster. In k-means, each cluster is associated with the centroid, and the objective of the k-means clustering is to find the is to minimize the sum of the distances between the point and their respective cluster centroid. So now let's look at the example to understand how k-means actually work. Okay, let's look at the example now to understand how k-means clustering actually works. So see, assume that we have these 8 data points and we want to apply k-means to create clusters for these points. So here how we can do it. Okay, so can you see this image? So we have 8 points and we want to apply k-means clustering, okay, to create the clusters for these points. Okay, so here is how we do it. So see, the first step is choose the number of cluster k. The first step in a k-means is to pick up the number of cluster k, and the second step is select k random points from the data as centroid. Select the k random points from the data as centroid. Next, we randomly select the centroid for each cluster. Let's say we want to have 2 cluster, so k is equal to 2 here. We then randomly select the centroid. So see here, we have 8 points. So first of all, we need to identify. The first thing is we need to choose the number of cluster k. So let's suppose we want to have 2 cluster. So k is equal to 2 here. After that, we need to randomly select the centroid. So see here. Here the red and green circles represent the centroid of these clusters. So let's suppose the k, the number of cluster you want to have 2. And then we need to randomly select the centroid. So let's suppose here red and green signal. Yeah, here red and green circle represent the centroid of these clusters. So this is first cluster, second cluster. So once you have 2 cluster, so k is equal to 2 here, we then randomly select the centroid. So select any 2 centroid. So here red and green circle represent the centroid for the clusters. Now what is the third step? Assign all the points to the closest cluster centroid. Assign the points to the nearest centroid. Assign all the data points to the closest cluster centroid. Closest cluster centroid. So once we have initialized the centroid, we assign each point to the closest cluster centroid. So see, we have selected these 2 clusters, C1 and C2. So after that, we assign all the data points to the nearest cluster centroid. So by looking at this image, so it looks like this point is near to this cluster. This point look like it's near to this C1 centroid. This is also near to this one. This is also near to this one. Yeah. Once we initialize the centroid, we assign each point to the closest cluster centroid. Okay. And then if you focus on these 2 points, so this point look like nearest to C2. This point look like nearest to C2. What about this point? This point look like nearest to C1. This centroid. So what is the third step? The third step is to assign all the points to the closest cluster centroid. So we have assigned 1, 2, 3, 4 point to the cluster C1, to the centroid C1. And we have assigned these 2 green circle or these 2 green point to the closest cluster centroid C2. Can you see this one? Okay. Now let's see the fourth step. The fourth step. Okay. Before that, see here. Here you can see that the point which are closer to the red points are assigned to the red cluster. Can you see this one? Whereas the point which are closer to the green point are assigned to the green cluster. So what are the points which is closest to the cluster centroid C1? So 1, 2, 3, 4. These four points are look like nearest to the cluster centroid C1. So you assign all these points to the closest cluster, and these two points look like nearest to the cluster centroid C2. So you assign it to the C2. Okay. Now let's see the fourth step. Recompute the centroid of a newly formed clusters. Recompute it. Now, once we have assigned all of that point to the either cluster, the next step is to compute the centroid of newly formed cluster. So here the red and green courses are the new centroids. So now we need to recompute the centroid of newly formed cluster. Okay. So let's suppose at this time, this, can you see this one green and red and green? See here, red and green courses are the new centroid. What is our fourth step? Once you assign all the points to the nearest cluster centroid, the next step is to compute the centroid of newly formed cluster. So let's suppose here the red and green courses are the new centroids. Now let's see the fifth step. Repeat the step 3 and 4. Repeat the step 3 and 4. What is the step 3? Assign all the points nearest to this cluster centroid. So it looks like these four points are nearest to this centroid. And it looks like 1, 2, 3, 4. These points are nearest to this cluster centroid. Can you see this one? Okay, so perform the step 3 and again step 4. Step 4 is nothing but again recompute it. What is the step 4? Recompute the centroid of a newly formed cluster. Okay, so recompute it. Take any other cluster centroid and verify it. See here. The step of computing the centroid and assigning all the points to the cluster based on their distance from the centroid is a single iteration. But wait, when should we stop this process? It can't run till eternity, right? Yeah, it can't run till eternity, right? So what is the step 5? Step 5 saying us to repeat the step 3 and 4. So at what time we should stop it? So what is the stopping criteria for k-means clustering? So see, there are essentially three stopping criteria that can be adopted to stop k-means algorithm. So first one is centroid of a newly formed cluster do not change. Centroid of the newly formed cluster do not get changed. Points remain in the same cluster and then maximum number of iterations are reached. Okay, so these are the criteria for stopping the k-means clustering. Okay, after, let's suppose once you got this one, okay, repeat the step 3 and 4. When we repeat the step 3 and 4, we got this one. Okay, after that, let's suppose if you want to again repeat the step 3 and 4, what is the step 3? The step 3 is about, once you perform the step 3, what you do? You will get this one. And in case of step 4, you compute the centroid of a newly formed cluster. Let's suppose at this time you want to have the centroid here. Okay, here. And for this one, if you want to have the centroid here. Okay. So even if you put it the centroid here, the closest data points to this cluster will be these four, and the closest data point for this centroid will be these four points. So what is the stopping criteria for k-means cluster? The points remain in the same cluster. Centroid of a newly formed cluster do not change. The centroid of a newly formed cluster should not get changed. That is the stopping criteria for k-means clustering. And what is the third one? Maximum number of iterations are reached. Got it? We can stop the algorithm if the centroid of a newly formed cluster are not changing. Even after multiple iterations, if we are getting the same centroid for all the clusters, we can say that the algorithm is not learning any new pattern and it is the sign to stop the training. Got it? Yeah? Yeah, got it. So I hope you got how does the k-means clustering work. So let's suppose you have these data points. Which one? This one. You have these data points. You have 8 points. And if you want to apply k-means to create the cluster for these data points, so we need to perform some step. So the first step is to identify or to choose the number of cluster you want. So the first step in a k-means is to pick up the number of cluster k. After that, you need to select k random point from the data as centroid. So we randomly select the centroid for each cluster. So let's say we want to have 2 cluster. So k is equal to 2 here. And then we randomly select the centroid. So you can see in this image. So C1 is the centroid of the first cluster. C2 is the centroid of the second cluster. So here the red and green circle represent the centroid of the clusters. Okay. Now what is the third step? The third step is to assign all the points to the closest cluster centroid. So what are the points which is closest to the centroid C1? 1, 2, 3, 4. These points look like closest to this centroid. And these two green circles, it look like nearest to the centroid C2. Okay. And what is our fourth step? Our fourth step is to recompute the centroid of a newly formed cluster. So once we have assigned all the points to the either cluster, the next step is to compute the centroid of a newly formed cluster. So let's suppose if you want to have the centroid here, the red and green crosses are the new centroid here. So red and green crosses. Again, after this one, once you assume the next or the newly formed centroid. So let's suppose if you are assuming this is the red and green crosses are the new centroid. So again, you need to repeat the step 3. Step 3 tells us what are the points nearest to this centroid. So it looks like 1, 2, 3, 4. These points are nearest to this centroid. And these 4 points are look like near to this centroid. So can you see this one? So it's look this data point become like this one. Yeah, 2 clusters. Okay, so again, we need to recompute it. Okay, so recompute the centroid of a newly formed clusters. So step 5 says repeat the step 3 and step 4. And then we have seen what is the stopping criteria for k-means clustering. So the first criteria is centroid of a newly formed cluster do not get changed. The point remain in a same cluster. And the third is maximum number of iterations are reached. Got it? So now I hope you understand k-means clustering. How does it work? Now it's time for us to start implementation of k-means clustering. So let's see implementing k-means clustering. Okay, so let's see the step on how the k-means machine learning algorithm works using the Python programming language. So here again, we are going to use the scikit-learn library, or you can say sklearn library, and some random data to illustrate k-means clustering simple explanation. Okay, so let's see implementation of k-means clustering with the help of scikit-learn library and some other libraries. So obviously the first step for implementing any algorithm is to import the necessary Python libraries or the packages. So import numpy.snp and then import matplotlib.pyplot.splt and then from sklearn.cluster import k-means. So here we are importing numpy for carrying out efficient computation and for generating some random data. We will see that. Okay. And we are using matplotlib in order to do the data visualization. And as we are implementing the k-means clustering, so we need to import k-means from sklearn.cluster. So we need to write from sklearn.cluster import k-means. After executing the step 1, the next step is to generate the data, get the data or generate the some random data. So see, here is the code for generating some random data in a two-dimensional space. So x is equal to -2 into np.random.rand rand 100, 2. So what is this? Yeah, tell me. First of all, np.random.rand 100, 2, what does it mean? So it is going to generate, it is going to create an array, yeah, two-dimensional array with 100 rows and 2 columns. Okay, 100 rows and 2 columns. If you want to see here, let me show you this step here by opening the Jupyter notebook. So see, I have already opened it. See, the first step is to import the necessary Python packages. Let me execute this code in front of you. So see, it become 4. If I execute it again, it will become 5. See here. And then if you just write np.random.rand 5, 2. So what is the meaning of this one? It is going to create an array of the given shape and populate it with the random sample from a uniform distribution over 0, 1. So if you write numpy.random.rand, so it is going to create an array of the given shape, okay, and populate it with the random sample from a uniform distribution over 0, 1. So if you write np.random.rand 5, 2, let me run this code in front of you. So see here, it becomes 6 here. So we are generating how the two-dimensional array look like here. See here. Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you can say 5 rows and 2 columns. Can you see this one? If you write 5, 3 here, so it is going to create like this one. See here. 5 rows, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 with 3 columns. This is the first one, second one, third one. Got it. So numpy.random.rand, it is going to create an array of a given shape and populate it with the random sample from a uniform distribution over 0, 1. So what is x here? We are putting x is equal to -2 into numpy.random.rand 100, 2. So 100, 2 means it is going to create 100 rows with 2 columns. And we are multiplying each of those value with -2. By the way, numpy.random.rand, this one, it is going to generate an array of a given shape and it is going to populate it with the random values from a uniform distribution over 0 and 1. So all the values, it is in between 0 and 1. Can you see this one? Yeah, so it is also going to generate the same thing with 100 rows and 2 columns. And all those values is we are going to multiply it with -2. And then x1 is equal to 1 plus 2 into numpy.random.rand 50, 2. So 50, 2 means 50 rows with 2 columns. So we are going to multiply each of these uniform distribution. Yeah. np.random.rand, it is going to generate an array of a given shape and populate it with the random values from a uniform distribution over 0 and 1. So all those values we are going to multiply with 2 and then we are going to do the addition of 18 and that will become our x1. Let me run this code in front of you. So it will become 8. If you want to see the value of x, let me run this code. So can you see this one? This is x. What is my x? It contains 100 rows with 2 columns. So see here, 100. If you count it, it will become 100. If you want to see x1, let me run this code. So this is my x1 that contains how many rows? 50 with 2 columns. So 50 rows are there. Got it? Yeah. So as per this code, a total of 100 data points has been generated and divided into 2 groups of each 50 points, of 50 point each. Okay, and here is the how the data is displayed on a two-dimensional space. So let first of all execute these 2 codes. So we have executed it. Okay, so we have generated the data for x and x1. Now what is like after that? What we are doing here? If you write x(5, 10), this is one. What is my x? What is the shape of x? Yeah, this is my x. Yeah, it's look like 100 rows with 2 columns. So if you write 5:10, like this one. So this means you want to select, this is for rows, comma, this is for column. So row number 5 till 9. So index row number 5 to 9, comma, this is for column. So all the columns from the row number 5 to 9 actually. So if you want to see how it works, so first of all, okay, let me just print it here x. So see, this is my x. So see, this is 0 row number, first row number, second row number, third row number, fourth row number, fifth row number. So see here, what is my fifth row number? Can you see this one? -6.86, -1.94. -1.64, minus, yeah. -6.86, -1.94. Can you see this one? From this point till this is 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th. Can you see this one? So whatever the data we have, it is going to start from the fifth row. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So from 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This one. -8.7241. Last value. -0.8724. Just a minute. X. -0.87. Where is that? -0.68. So see, once I execute it again, the values are going to change because it's a random data. So see, x, once I execute it, after that, if you want to see the values of x, so here comes the values of x. And then x of 5:10. So all the rows from 5th index position till 9th index position and all the columns. So see here. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. -0.32. -1.98. So see here, -0.32. -1.98. Is it correct? Yes, see here. -0.323280. -0.323280 and -1.98. So see, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So here comes, this is 5th row, 6th row, 7th row, 8th row, 9th row. So 5 to 9. So what is the last row? 1, -1.999, -1.60. Is it correct? Yeah, -1.999, -1.60. Got it? How we selecting the particular row? Yeah, with all the columns. Now what I'm doing here, I'm assigning the values of all x1 values to x of 50:100, comma nothing. So this means, what is my x1? This is my x1. Where is my x1? This one. X1 is going to contain 50 rows with 2 columns. Yeah. So if you want to see the value of x1, so let me run this code again in front of you. So here comes x1. So x1 is containing 50 rows with 2 columns and x is containing 100 rows with 2 columns. So see, I am assigning x1 to the rows from 50 to last one. From 50th index till last row. Okay, comma, all the columns. Okay, so I'm assigning all this value to this value. Let me run this code. Okay, and what is the length of x? If you want to find ln of x, that is 100. 100 rows, yeah. So I have assigned it. Okay, and then what I'm doing, I'm creating the scatter plot for it. So see, x1, I have assigned x1 is equal to this one. I have assigned all the values of x1 to x of 50:100, comma this one. 50:100 means from 50th row till the last row, comma all the column. So now plt.scatter x of, what is mean by this one? Tell me. The meaning of this one is, the initial is this for row. So you're not specifying anything. So x of all the rows of zero column, that is our first column. All the data of the first column, comma, all the data of second column. So zero column, first column, and then color is equal to blue, and then plt.show. Let me run this code in front of you. So it's running, just wait. Got it? Yes, how we got it? The scatter plot. Yeah. So see, how we got it? So we have created the scatter plot that will clearly show us two clusters or two groups. Yeah. Now let us see the step 3. Training the K-means algorithm using scikit-learn. Okay. Now we will use some of the available functions in the scikit-learn library to process the randomly generated data. As we have got the number of cluster, so now we can train the model on the data set. So right from sklearn.cluster import k-means, and then k-means, that is our algorithm, and then n underscore cluster, that is number of cluster, is equal to 2. The result of this one you can assign to k-means any variable, and then once you got it, you need to fit the data. Yeah, you need to fit the model with the data, with the training data, you can say. Yeah, so after that, what you need to do, the fourth step is to find the centroid. So see, here is the code for finding the centroid or finding the center of the cluster. So k-mean dot cluster underscore center underscore, so you will get an array. So let us execute the step 3 and 4. So what is the step 3? Step 3 is training the k-means algorithm and use by using the scikit-learn. So see here, so from sklearn.cluster import k-means, by the way, we have already imported it here from sklearn.cluster import k-means, and then k-means inside that supply the number of cluster. Okay, the result of this one you can assign to any variable, and then this one k-mean, if you're writing one here, so k-mean.fit. Okay, fit the model on training data, train the data on training data and fit it. So k-mean1.fit x. Let me run this code in front of you. So see, it's running, it become 21. So here comes k-means. Now the next step is finding the center. What is the fourth step? The fourth step is finding the centroid. So here is the code for finding the center of the cluster, or you can say here is the code for finding the centroid. So k-mean, that is our model, k-mean one dot cluster underscore centers underscore. So let me run this code. So you will get some other value based on the random data. So here comes the array. Okay. See here. This is our centroid of two clusters. Okay. So -1.10. What we are getting? -1.04. Whatever it is. Well, since we have generated some random data with the help of NumPy, so you might get some other values also here. But this is nothing but the centroid, the center of cluster. Okay, center of the cluster, or you can say the centroid. After that, if you want to display the cluster centroid using green and red color, so how can you do this? So again, you can create a scatter plot. So plt.scatter x, since x contain total 100 data. So see here, what is this? You're not providing any rows, so this means selecting all the rows of the zero column, that is first column, comma x of square bracket all the rows of first column, that is second column. This zero index, that is zero, is nothing but zero column. Yeah, first column zero row, second first row, second row. In the same way, zero column first column, or you can say it's a first column, it is a second column. Color is equal to blue, and then plt.scatter. So see here, what is the centroid here? What is the center of the cluster? These two things. First one is this one, second one is this one. So you can put this value here, plt.scatter. Let me copy it. Let me paste it here. Okay. And then this one, I need to put it here. Okay. See here, in this PP also, you will find if this is a centroid of the cluster, then see the first point -1.10, -1.09, and then 1.90, and then 2.09. So two scatter plots. Okay, so after that I need to copy it here, and I need to paste it here, and I need to copy it and paste it here. So here is the centroid or the center of the cluster, and then yeah, size 200 200, color green for this scatter plot. For this scatter plot, great. Marker S, that is square, yeah, square shape, both of them. So PLT dot scatter, you're putting the centroids. Yeah, this is a coordinate for the shape S, the with marker S shape, yeah, square with the color green. So here comes the point. So see here, -1.04 -1.03. So -1.04 -1.03. So here comes the centroid or the center of the cluster with the green color, with the marker is equal to S, that is square. And here comes the another centroid with 2.0 1.98. so 2.0 here, 1.98 is here. That is the second centroid, yeah, with the color red, with the marker square. Got it? Yes. And then what is the fifth step? Let's see the fifth step. The fifth step is testing the algorithm. So here is a code for getting the labels property of the k-means clustering example data set. That is how the data are categorized into two clusters. So you just need to execute this one, k-means.labels_. So let me run this code. K-mean, the name of my model, dot labels. So then I will execute this code. So see here, the result of this one. Can you see this one? So you can see the result. 50 data points belong to the zero cluster, while the rest belong to the one cluster. Can you see this one? 50 data points belong to the zero cluster, and remaining data points belong to the one cluster. Can you see this one? So finally, we have done with the implementation of k-means clustering algorithm. Okay. Yes. Got it. Now let us use the code below for predicting the cluster of the data point. Okay, now once you build the k-means clustering the model, now it's time for us to use the code for predicting the cluster of data point. And by the way, I hope you remember, once we develop the regression model, or once we develop the logistic regression model, or once we develop the support vector machine model, once we done with the decision tree model, we will use some data for predicting the values, for predicting. Okay. So now in the same way, let us use the blow code for predicting the cluster of the data point. So suppose if you have the NumPy array, so -3.0, -3.0. The result of this one you are assigned to sample_test. So sample_test is the variable that is ND array. Okay, that contain these two values. Now second test is equal to sample_test.reshape1, -1, and then name of the model, k-means.predict second test. Now let's see the output of this one. See here, numpy.array -3.0, -3.0. The result of this one you are assigning to the variable, and then you are reshaping it. sample_test.reshape1, -1. The result of this one you are assigning to second test, and then you're using k-mean model dot predict second test. Let me run this code. So can you see the output 0? This means it shows that test data point belong to the zero cluster, or you can say green cluster, this one. If you write -3.0, if you make it +3, let's see the code, what is going to happen. Again it is coming 0. If you make it 3, then it will come here. Can you see this one? So this sample data point comes under the one cluster, that is red. Okay. Yeah, red centroid. Got it? Yes. So finally, we have done with the k-means clustering. So how we implemented it? So it's very easy. Import the necessary Python packages and then generate some data, random data x and x1. And then we have created the scatter plot. Before creating the scatter plot, we have assigned all the values of x1 to all the values from 50th row till the last row of x. Okay. Yeah, you can see this one. And then we have created the scatter plot for x. okay, for a first column and then the second column. So you see here, there comes the scatter plot. And then the third step is to create the k-means cluster, okay, using this one. So from sklearn, using the sklearn. So from sklearn.cluster, import k-means, and then use k-means, provide the argument n underscore cluster is equal to 2, that is number of cluster, and then k-mean 1, and then fit the model with training data, k-mean 1 dot fit to x. And then to find the centroid or find the center of cluster, you need to write k-mean dot cluster underscore centers underscore centers. So you will get this, that is this point, this point comma this point is the centroid. Okay, this is first one. So see here, it look like here, this one green. This is a green centroid with the coordinate -1.0, -1.03. And this is the red centroid with the coordinate 2.05, 1.98. And how we created it? Again, with the help of scatter plot, we will visualize it. And then came in dot labels one, and you can directly see this one. So we have total 100 data points, so it is classified. 50 data points belong to the zero cluster and remaining data points belong to the one cluster. Yeah. And then after developing the k-mean clustering model, we have predicted the sample data points. Yeah, we have predicted. We have used the code for predicting the cluster of the data points. Yeah, sorry, the cluster of the data points. So what is the a data point belong to which cluster? Either it belong to the green cluster or red cluster. So we have provided some data here, 3.0, 3.0. If you point 3.0, 3.0, we are getting this data point belong to the one cluster. If you make it -3.0, then can you see this one? This data point belong to the zero cluster. This means green cluster. Got it? Yeah. So I hope you understand till now what is clustering, what are the algorithms under the clustering, and what is k-means clustering. How does it work? How does k-means clustering work? And what is the stopping criteria for k-means clustering? And I hope you understand implementation of k-means clustering with the help of Python code. Yes. Now what I will do, I will continue with this session with the next point of hierarchical clustering. Okay. Yeah. So I hope you understand all the things about the clustering, how, what is clustering, what are the algorithms under clustering, what is k-means clustering, how does k-means clustering work, and the implementation of k-means clustering. And once you develop the k-means, once you implement it, k-means clustering, how can you use the code for predicting the cluster of data point? Okay, so this data point -3.0 comma -3.0, what does it belong to? It belong to the zero. This means it shows that this data point belong to the zero cluster or green centroid. Got it? So I will continue with the next point of hierarchical clustering in the next session. Okay.